Where am I going to right now? I'm going to meet a really special friend now. He's a copywriter and one of really the best in the world, to be honest. And he seldom does interviews and podcasts. And I have really the honor and privilege of getting to know him. And his name is Kenneth Yu. And he's a really excellent storyteller. But more importantly, he's got this convincing power that gets people to part with their money. So I'm going to ask him some questions that I hope will be able to not just help me, but help you as well to get more sales and get more money for ourselves. Okay, so coming back soon. Like you're really rough guy, just can't get enough guy, just always so puff guy. I'm not bad. Hi everybody, this is Andrew Tan, and today I am with a copywriting expert, Kenneth Yu, here, and doing a short conversation on how you should be setting up your stories to be able to sell. Okay, so we'll be getting to know him a little bit better, and then I hope that this video edifies you or helps you in your own journey as an entrepreneur as well. Hi, Kenneth.
Hello.
Pleasure meeting you again today.
Yeah, okay. Pleasure, Andrew.
Yeah. Just to give a bit of background for everybody, Kenneth is my mentor in copywriting, and I've learned quite a lot about selling from him. And today is really an honor for me to be able to get him to come and talk to you today to share his gems. Hi, Kenneth. Okay. So for the audience sake, can you introduce a bit more about yourself to everyone, please?
Okay, sure. So my name is Kenneth. I tell stories that part people from their money.
That's a good.
And I teach others to do the same. And generally, I do accept copywriting projects from site to site. So I do a bit of freelance, but most of the time, I'm just doing it to build my businesses already. So I've been partnering with a lot of people, and we are doing business because I have the gift of copywriting. I'm not teaching other people to do that as well.
Okay. Tell them a bit more about like where you came from, like your achievements in Mind Valley and...
Okay. So before I started my own business about 11 years ago, first I was in Ogilvy and Mater. Do you know O&M?
Yes, O&M.
So I was advertising. Yeah. So I was in above the line advertising for 3 years, won about 12 international awards. Mostly one award I didn't win, but I won everything pretty much in 3 years. That means I have a branding background, which is very important, as I explain later. Yeah. And then I was in Mind Valley as the copy chief for about 2 years. Mm-hmm. According to one of the co-founders, Vision's co-founder at the time, Mike, said that I doubled the revenue of Mind Valley in that 1 year I was there. So I implemented the email systems, the funnels. In fact, we were one of the first few people to do sales funnels in the world.
Actually. Awesome, awesome. Yeah. So one of the pioneers of the funnels industry here as well. How did you get started in copywriting? How did it become your craft?
Okay, a direct response copywriting is Vishal Lakiani, the founder of Mind Valley, just gave me a book. And he was like, yes, I did this. Write your sales letter. And that's actually how I started.
No kidding. It was that simple.
Yeah.
So is it considered by luck?
Yeah, I think a lot of life is luck, right? Yeah. So a lot of things is, I mean, I have a bit of skill in terms of I can write, my English not bad. Yeah. And then he gave me this book, and luckily I can learn from that because there was no techniques, nothing, no strategies, no
frameworks. How important is your command of English in copywriting? Because where am I coming from is there are many people, especially coming from our region, English is really not their first language. So the question is, can a person whose English is not so good become good at copywriting?
You have to see your target audience. Mm-hmm. So if your English is not that great, but if your audience, the English is not so powerful, so then okay. Basically, then you can communicate. But if you want to do that and you want to, like, let's say, target English-speaking audience, then the command needs to be higher. But generally, they did say that your command English needs to be in a 14-year-old level. That's what they say of English. Then your copy needs to resonate with that.
14-year-old sounds still okay. So that does that mean that the more simplified the way of communicating is actually the better? Is that
it is, because you see, copywriting is an emotional craft.
Yeah.
There's a bit of science to it, but it's emotional, which means that if you write in a way that when somebody has to use their head instead, their mind instead, it interferes with the emotional process. So the easier the language, the smoother it is, the less people think, the more people feel.
So in terms of, let's say, getting people to buy, Say we have a spectrum, right in the middle is 5, and then there's 10 and there's 1. Actually, 1 becoming logic and 10 becomes emotions. Where does it lie to get people to part their money with?
Depends on industry.
Okay. I mean, let's say e-commerce per se.
I mean, e-commerce, you will go to 7 and 8. But here's the thing. What I realized, right, because I study human behavior.
Yeah.
Is that human beings are not very logical, generally. Okay. Even if you sell a B2B product, let's say IBM or Sitecore, you know, very boring corporate product. Okay. You go see the CTO and everything. The CTO still needs to like you to get your product. Like basically, there's still a human connection in order to buy, even though there's supposed to be a lot of features, supposed to buy purely by features. But even in the highest levels of government and of big business, emotions still matter.
I see. Is there... So let's say, okay, you are saying 7 and 8. Emotions actually rule majority of the transactions out there. Is there a formula that anyone can use, or is it really unique to the individual?
There's something... I think I taught you guys before. It's called DEDA.
Okay, let the audience know about that.
Okay, so DEDA is called Dark Emotions That Drive Action. So a few principles here. The first one is positive emotions don't really move people.
Yeah.
People, I feel people want to escape pain more than they want to embrace joy, or they want to embrace pleasure.
Okay.
It's usually they want to escape from something.
Okay.
You take something pleasurable in order to escape the pain. So, and someone did say that you are more motivated, 10 times more motivated to buy something out of fear of loss than promise of gain. So there's a few of these principles.
Yeah.
So
And yet here's the thing. Okay, I'm coming from my experience. Yeah. Like whenever we do our marketing, we do have teams of people that we work with, and some will say we should always frame it in the positive.
Yeah.
And yet now you're saying mostly people would do something to avoid the pain. So, many copies in the market are always, in my opinion, a bit of gloom and doom. Gloom and doom. Is that really how copy is supposed to go?
It doesn't have to be doom and gloom.
Yeah.
But I think what someone needs to be mindful of is people don't really buy solutions.
Okay.
Meaning, for instance, I mean, at the most basic, I'll show you a basic, I'll show you more of a seminar level. So on the basic level, people buy Panadol to relieve a headache.
Yeah.
They don't buy it in order to, you know, to feel good. They buy it because
they relieve the pain.
To relieve the pain.
Yeah.
So when someone advertises, let's say, an NLP seminar, let's say a neuro-linguistic seminar.
Yes.
When you advertise it based on solution, meaning, okay, this is an NLP seminar, we learned this, NLP secrets from Richard Bandler, let's say. Your market is very tiny.
Yeah.
But when you say, do you feel that you're stuck in life? Do you feel that you don't have good relationships, you're in an addiction pattern over and over again, and you're so desperate to break out, and you can't break out? NLP is the solution for that, to escape from this addiction cycle.
Okay, so let's use current, now NLP, the example is good, and it gives a framework.
Yeah.
Can we use some examples that are really like a bit more current? Like for example, right now, coronavirus is really the big thingy that's happening. So there's all these fear and emotions that's going around the public. So how can something like that be used in a products market for people to buy things? Let's say it's not mask, okay?
Yeah.
Can we think of a product somewhere?
I may not do that. Like, if it's a coronavirus, it's a sensitive issue.
Yeah.
Because I remember, I think it was Kenneth Cole, the fashion brand.
Yeah.
And then the tsunami hit, and then they tweeted, "Here, enjoy our tsunami of sales."
Okay.
They got screwed because of that. So it needs to be, I think, in good taste as well.
Okay.
And it needs to be related. Like if the coronavirus related, let's say medical or anything to do with safety, you can use it and you should use it.
Okay.
But if it's something that's unrelated, then there's a danger of, then you can use other form of pain and other foul triggers to help with that. Yeah.
Do you have like case studies or stories of really what's considered good copy or bad copy of a certain product? Then at least our audience can get to know.
There's no bad or good copy.
Okay.
There's only copy that resonates or doesn't resonate.
Okay.
Because I think when I did copywriting for a very long time, People, my reputation in industry was, I was a very skilled copywriter. That means the craft of copywriting, I was very good. But there was a period of time, a couple of years ago, where none of my copy hit. Like, it was very polished.
Okay.
My English was like power, everything was good, but it wasn't converting. And the reason for that is I realized that my copy wasn't actually resonating with the target audience.
I see.
I was too snobbish.
Okay.
That I thought I knew what the market wanted, okay, than to actually give the market what they want.
Okay.
Let me give you a very good example of good copywriting. It sounds really controversial, but then I like talking about controversial topics.
Let's do it, man.
The best copywriter in the world is the devil.
Okay. So does that mean that we need to bring out the devil within ourselves?
No. There's a concept that the devil, like if you watch all the movies, all the TV shows where somebody has made a deal with the devil and they give up their soul.
Yeah.
But that is so stupid, man. Like basically, why want to go to hell, give your devil the soul? Like basically, the price that you pay is so great, but yet the devil almost always gets what he wants in these sort of TV shows. And the whole reason for that, right, is because the devil actually gives what people really, really want.
Okay.
He say, I can actually give you what you really, really want inside you, and this is the price. And even the price is eternity in hell, people are willing to pay it. So copywriting needs to really hit on what people really, really want. Because if you can hit on what people really, really want, then in a sense, your investment that you command will be a lot higher.
Mm. And seriously, thank you for that. I think you really hit the nail on the head there.
Yeah.
Then the following question would be, how do you fish out really people's real desires? Because there are many layers when we come to the audience. How do we fish out?
Yeah, it's a concept called MHFI.
Okay. yes. Miserable home, fantasy island.
Yes.
Yes. Please tell the audience more about that.
Yeah, it's something I made famous. So it's an exercise where you get to know someone's insight in a very quick way. So you just divide a paper into half. The first is MH, which stands for miserable home, and then fantasy island. And in the miserable home, and why it's home is because it's where they are right now, it's where they're stuck right now. You put all the things they don't like, the things they're not satisfied with, the just their dissatisfactions in life. It could be general, it could be specific to your product or service or industry. It doesn't matter. Sometimes I just put everything.
Yeah.
So like, marriage not good lah, or disrespectful kids lah, or not married lah. Like basically, all the things that are a miserable home. The fantasy island is the opposite.
Mm.
So basically, it's the opposite of no money, I have bills every month, is now I got money, now I got bills every month.
Mm.
Now I don't have to pay any more bills, now I can have a laptop, work by the beach, and all those things. So fantasy island is that island that escape, meaning that if I were to go to that island, all my problems go away.
Mm.
And so I do this exercise very quickly, and then I can ascertain what people want already.
How do you do your research then? Is how much is own self created, and how much really you go online to research people's MH?
It depends on the industry and which country as well. In the US, you can research online because the US is far bigger. That means you go on Reddit and all those things. It's quite accurate, like the things, the sentiments. Actually, this is a good tip. If your audience is not local, if your audience, let's say, is a Western audience, go on Reddit.com.
Reddit, okay.
Yeah. And Reddit is basically a forum site. It's like Lau Yat Forum in Malaysia and all those things.
Yeah.
So you have Reddit, and there's subreddits, which means there are people talking about specific things, either keto diet lah, or all those things.
Mm.
And you just see the way they talk, the speech patterns they use, the things they say, and then that's how you can internalize. If it's local, then just go local. That means if there's not much data, then you find data by being on the ground and talking with people. I find one of the things I do that may sound a bit creepy, like sound like a spy, is basically I go to a mama, I go to a restaurant, and then I just, if I'm eating alone, I just hear what people are talking.
Okay.
I just eavesdrop on conversations.
Okay.
So I actually know the sentiment of people when I do that. And then I just target from there.
I see that. Is that always a rule of thumb that we should always go and fish out people's miserable homes first?
We should, because sometimes we are not the target audience.
Yeah.
I mean, we are the target audience very easy.
Yeah.
Then our problem is their problem.
Yeah.
But a lot of times it's not.
which is more important, the MH or the FI?
You need the MH order to get the FI.
Okay.
Because FI is the opposite of the MH.
But then when the let's say we talk about a whole copy, the beginning,
yeah,
the middle and the end.
Yeah.
I have heard that usually the first 3 minutes of engagement would usually set up for the whole entire copy. How true is that?
I think it's very true. Like copywriting, especially copywriting for sales letters, is very weird.
Yeah.
It's very weird because you need to write that 20 minutes or 25 minutes or whatever. It's a long... I mean, I'm talking about video sales letters, but
yeah,
you know, sales letters is typically 3,000 words.
Yeah.
It's like, can I cut it down to 200 words? No, yeah, you can't. But at the same time, the 2,000 words is useless if the first three paragraphs don't capture someone's attention. Because people need to read through it. In order to read through it, they need to actually know what's in it for them.
Okay.
In order to read through.
Is there a framework to make this 3 minutes really kick?
I have a few strategies. And I think it's the principle I call the principle of one pill away.
Ah, just one pill away.
Just one pill away.
Okay.
So OPA, what that means, I call it OPA. It's a new thing I actually developed recently.
Cool.
Everything I do now is actually OPA. Meaning, right, that human beings, right, can only incorporate 7 pieces of information at any given time.
Yes.
Only 7.
Yes.
I mean, they're now their attention span is less than a goldfish. It's actually 6 seconds, goldfish is 8 seconds. So it's, yeah, actually less than a goldfish now.
Yeah.
Which means, right, that your attention span is very limited. So your sales letter need to actually tell them, if you are this one breakthrough away or one pill away from changing your life,
yeah,
or from escaping MH to go to FI.
Yeah.
So basically, your sales letter or whatever you do,
yeah,
needs to say this one thing, you need to believe this one thing, yeah, will take you to the next level. And so you have the OPA in the first, so you basically say, we have this one thing that if you believe will go there. What I find actually very interesting is something I call breach of mind. It's something new as well, which is pattern interrupt.
Okay.
So basically you tell a story in, like you just tell a story at the beginning that has nothing related to do with anything.
Yeah.
And then you slowly build it towards the sales letter and everything. So you have a beginning that, you know, why like that? Like one of my new sales letters I wrote, so we're partnering to do that, has a man getting eaten by a hippo. So hippo at the man, his legs are dangling outside like chopsticks. Like basically, so people are like, oh, what the hell is going on?
Yeah.
Yeah. So I like that sort of thing. I like it if it's related or not related. I don't really care. As long as I get someone's attention first.
So now that brings me to open up another bigger thing.
Yeah.
It feels like the world of sales is changing so much quicker nowadays.
Yeah.
And human behaviors, what we have talked about, attention spans are really, really getting shorter.
Yeah.
So for lack of a better expression,
yeah,
how is the newbie gonna cope? What's more like, maybe let me be a bit more specific.
Yeah.
If it's really changing, so what's happening on the consumer side that's, yeah, causing them to change?
Yeah.
And what can us as salespeople do to find those things that would never change, that would always work despite evolution?
I think, I think all aspects of persuasion is, I think, doesn't really change. Like you need to know, as long as you know what resonates.
Yeah.
Like, the devil has been doing deals for years, right?
Yeah,
So basically, you just need to know what ticks in the person, and it usually doesn't change. I think one of the principles I use is you give people what they want in a way that they don't expect.
Okay.
Which is actually the principle of the UFO. I think I thought the UFO before, but
yeah,
I think I built up the UFO like crazy. I'll explain what the UFO is in a minute. I'm actually going to share the UFO in California and Sweden this year.
Okay.
So just the concept of the UFO. So UFO stands for Unique Fantasy Object.
Hmm.
Remember I talked about one pill away?
Yes, I remember.
So the one pill away, the UFO is really, what is that pill? What is that one thing away?
Yeah.
Unique. And why fantasy is like MHFI, you get the fantasy island. Unique is a unique way you express the FI in an object form, in a way, in an offer sort of thing. So So basically, what people want has not changed for centuries. People want love, people want money, people want sex, people want to escape, people want a house, people want security. All those don't change.
Or are these like Maslow's hierarchy?
Yeah, it's Maslow's hierarchy.
Okay.
Yeah. But how they want it changes.
So in other words, what you're saying here is human behavior doesn't really change much.
Yeah.
It's always based on the few emotional needs that they are looking for.
Yeah.
And what they want is the solution packaged in a nice pretty bow tie.
Yeah.
And a new way that they have never heard before.
Yeah, it's a bow tie with a color they haven't seen before.
Okay.
Yeah, because human beings, especially now, like novelty.
Yeah.
So the key is if you can be able to satisfy their need for novelty, chances are they will buy what you want, provided it's something they want in the first place inherently.
Yeah.
The main issue is as we live in this reality where you need to consistently come out with something unique, which means that then there needs to be an innovation kind of methodology where you can come up with new ideas.
Okay.
All the time.
Okay. And do you have a formula how you find all these little things that innovate? I'm really throwing it out here because if you were to ask me, I would say daily life stuff. Anything that really resonates at that point of time, write it down, and then maybe that's just your new innovation.
Yeah.
Do you have a formula?
I'm actually working on one.
Okay.
It's called the Chimera.
Chimera?
Yeah.
The Greek mythology.
Yeah, the Greek mythology.
Okay.
So if Chimera, according if your viewers don't know, is a mythical creature with a head of a lion, a body of a goat.
And wings of the dragon. And
wings of the dragon, tail of a snake, yeah.
Yeah.
So the interesting thing is all of these creatures on its own are not so scary. When you combine them, become this really scary creature. That means you have some that's bigger than the parts. The whole is bigger than the parts and everything. And I realized, right, that if your thinking is like a chimera, if your thinking is multidisciplinary, then the possibilities are endless. That means the possibilities rapidly expand.
This sounds like something one of my friends lately has been saying that we should always choose cross disciplines between industries to apply.
Yeah.
So like say I'm from e-commerce.
Yeah.
Maybe I could take something from real estate.
Yeah.
Maybe I can take something from fashion.
Yeah.
But bring it into, is that something like what Chimera is?
Chimera is that and more. Let me give you, so the Chimera is basically, I think I can add on a visual later. So basically it's three circles.
Yeah.
And it's actually a circle of competence.
Okay.
So the first is the circle where you're really, you're uniquely gifted in. The second is things you're passionate about, things you like. And the third is a discomfort zone. Basically things that you have you're not very good at or you don't have a lot of familiarity at.
Yeah.
But, so that's standard management training, management philosophy.
Okay.
But then the Chimera is basically with all these three, you add one more line. And that one line is the innovation line.
Okay.
That means the more your circle expands, the more innovative you become. Which means the more you're more well-versed in things you're not very good at,
okay,
the more ideas actually flow.
Okay.
And so it could be cross-discipline. It could be in terms of creativity, like if you like, let's say, Jay Chou songs, you start listening to more heavy metal.
Yeah.
you watch movies, that's damn weird. Or you go to another country, you travel. So what happens is your circle actually keeps expanding and then the line keeps growing as well.
Okay. I kind of only sort of get this, but I'll work on that one. And Chimera sounds like a really big game changer right now.
Yeah.
So let's recap a few things.
Yeah.
If we really talk about storytelling, it's really finding first the MH.
Yeah.
And then selling them, seeding them the FI.
Yeah.
But at the same time, have a UFO that gives a bit of a novelty effect.
Yeah.
People like the novelties.
Yeah.
But in terms of the evolution of storytelling or copywriting, the Chimera becomes the formula for innovation that constantly brings in new ideas.
Yep.
So far we've come to that.
Yeah.
I hope I'm really putting the frame.
Yeah, you did, yeah.
Okay, and here's the other thing. Now, what is happening to consumers that actually led up to copywriting really needing so much of changes nowadays?
Yeah. So I think what's happening now, and the reason why I teach copywriting now, like, yeah, I have courses, I have mentoring programs, everything. For the longest time, I never taught anything.
Okay.
First, I was like, who's going to listen to me? I prefer to...
you're one of... I'm not kidding. I mean, even though I've been in this market for quite some time, when I sat in your class, like, it's just late last year, you have blown my mind with so many new ways of structuring my thinking. That's really current.
Yeah.
And that, sincerely, I'm thankful to you for it. Because I use that even in my own copy nowadays.
Wow,
and that would really help many people who are primarily stuck. If people say, I just don't know what to do, that's the framework that really gives people what they need to do.
Yeah.
Okay, so let's talk about people.
Okay.
The consumers.
Consumers.
Yeah.
So basically, I think what's been happening and why copywriting needs to evolve is a lot of the copywriting principles we learn, the direct response, are from people who already died. Basically, it's the only industry, right, where everybody just talks about people who died. Like, that's the Bible, the textbook of people who died.
Okay.
You don't see that in science. You don't see that in other industry.
Yeah.
Everything's very current, but copywriting... I mean, I know this respect. They're amazing. Yeah. David Ogilvy is amazing. Gene Schwartz is amazing. I respect them, but, you know, they remain there. It's so weird.
Yeah.
But what's happened is this market, it's basically what happened is in the early days, there's five levels. We had the five levels of market sophistication.
Okay.
And this actually came from Gene Schwartz.
Okay.
Gene Schwartz talks about the five levels of market sophistication. And he said that at level one is the market that is the least competitive.
Okay.
That means if you're a bakery, you're the only bakery in the world or in the village or whatever. Level five is that a lot of competitors.
Mm.
Like all your bread stories are competitors. So let me just go and address each one.
Okay.
So level one market, and most of you are not going to be in a level one market. Very rarely you're in a level one market. Although somebody I know does alpaca farming.
Mm-hmm.
Farming with alpaca fur and everything. So I think he's level one probably.
Primary industry. Yeah.
Primary industry. Yeah. But level one is basically in a small village last time, if you bake bread, it used to be you're the only baker in the village.
Yeah.
That's why even in the Western countries, you have people called John Baker, John Potter, Harry Potter, like basically. Yeah. It's because that was that's how they identify by that one job or by that one role.
Yeah.
So if you're the only one doing bread, you don't need any differentiation. You don't need any marketing.
Yeah.
You just say white bread here.
Okay.
Everybody goes.
That's
level one.
Okay.
Level two is when you have a secondary competitor that comes in. And now, both of you can't just do white bread. You need to also... So someone maybe does brown bread and you do white bread and then there's competition. So that's a level two market. Then you need to be a bit clever.
Okay.
Level three is there's more bakers. Now there's five, six, seven. How do you differentiate? And you differentiate based on a unique mechanism.
Okay.
So you can say, instead of white bread and brown bread, now the way I make it is also different.
Okay.
So it makes it more special. Like this bread is using, you know, sourdough starters from my ancestors 50 years ago, something like that. So now I make sourdough bread that based on starters.
Is that at level three, is it the story or is it just that something extra?
It's both.
Okay.
So it's, you can actually craft the story and then add on the unique mechanism.
Oh, okay.
So sometimes you're like, okay, this story is more compelling, let's add it. The problem is if you write the story but you don't add anything extra to back it up, then that's a problem.
So there must be the story plus the facts that put it together. Okay.
Yeah. And then number four is you need an even crazier unique mechanism. So so instead of like, you know, a brown bread made with sourdough 50 years ago, now you say this brown bread made with sourdough 50 years ago by monks in this monastery, like in the south of France. Like basically it goes really crazy because now it's a really special, really exclusive, unique bread.
And do buyers really buy into such far-fetched stuff?
Yeah.
Okay. Says it all.
People believe anything. I mean, look at how much fake news is going on. And usually who pass on the fake news are the baby boomers, right? Or in WhatsApp.
No, actually, that's kind of... It fucks my logic in a certain way. I always think that customers are usually logical. They'll buy things because they want to gain some pleasure or remove some pain. But yet, some little spark of gossip can really move the masses rather than what we say as the story. So my question here is that how much of these kind of unverified quote unquote gossip actually plays in the, how much weightage does it have in a person's decision to buy?
Very high. I actually did a study recently of 40 cognitive biases. 40.
Wow.
So that means like 40 different brain bugs. There are things in your head that human beings have, almost like Microsoft Windows in the early days. It's very buggy, it keeps crashing.
Yeah.
So the brain actually has 40 different cognitive biases. One of which is the recency bias.
Okay.
And the recency bias is things that are more current, are more important, and hold more weight.
Yeah.
Which means the current gossip is the one that holds more weight over facts that are very long ago.
Okay.
Yeah, so that's.
So if let's say, now we are still at level four here.
Yeah.
If let's say at level four, we throw in some of these cognitive biases.
Yeah.
And does that mean that it would influence customers to buy more if we know how to skillfully use even one of these 40 cognitive biases?
I believe once you hit level 4 and 5, it's a bloodbath. In a sense, it's a war of attrition.
Okay.
Meaning, it's like, who has the biggest weapons win?
Okay.
So the things I built for myself and my clients and my companies are things that I use heavy duty. That means I prepared to go to war. Okay. I prepared to go to, but I have 50 commanders, I don't care. I have the best. I got the biggest guns.
Okay.
I come in and I win.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay. So that's level 4.
Yeah.
How does it lead to level 5?
Level 5 is that it's like crazy. So basically you have so many competitors. And that's where I think nearly all, if you're in Singapore and Malaysia.
Yeah.
If you're a financial planner, you know. Like
There's so much competition.
Yeah.
There's so much price war.
Yeah.
There's always, there's even cutthroat under the belt kind of competition.
Yeah. Yeah.
How do we as sellers now even become victorious in this kind of market?
There are two ways.
Yeah.
So the first way is to go big.
Okay.
Meaning you use more weaponry. That means you use more cognitive biases, more psychological weaponry, more branding, more storytelling. And the second way is to niche it down.
Okay.
To sub-niche it into another category.
Okay.
So there are two ways. So meaning that if there's one specific, let's be last time crypto, it would be like, let's say Bitcoin.
Yeah.
Now you can do, I don't know, crypto exchanges, crypto, like basically different aspects of crypto. So you sub-niche it.
Yeah.
So when you sub-niche it, then it says it could be level one, level two market.
Okay. Again. So so does that mean that even in level five, whenever we sub-niche and carve out our own small pie, we can literally bring that back to level one, level two?
You can. So depending, for me, I like to do both.
Okay.
And then I still like to tap out this.
Yeah.
Then, because the thing with level one, level two is the market is not so big also.
Yeah.
Which means that it's not a lot of competition, but there's also not a lot of money to be made.
Yeah.
Because where the money is made is the most competitive niches. That's where the multi-million dollar fortunes are to be made, or billion dollar fortunes are all made.
Okay.
In this.
And while we are talking about level one to level five, I really can't help but ask, in all this evolution, what are the few guns that we can use that will always work? Especially if we talk about really the tip of the sword, which is human behaviors are illogical. Mm. It doesn't change, and you've been studying human behavior for the longest time.
Yeah.
So it's two parts. What doesn't change that we can use to still cater to all these things that would get the customer to buy?
Okay. So there's a storytelling framework I'm developing, and I taught this to some of the Silicon Valley companies already.
Okay.
It's called the Scalable Parable.
Scalable Parable.
Yeah.
Tell us more, please.
Okay. I took religious conversion texts. Because here's the thing. It comes on the premise of this.
Mm.
Religion has a higher penetration rate than most brands.
Okay.
So if you look at, let's say, Christianity, 44% in the world.
Okay.
McDonald's is not even 44% in the world. Okay. Apple isn't 44% in the world.
Okay.
And the total religious population of the world is about 80%, even worldwide. So if you actually treat religion as a brand,
yeah,
you're like, okay, what are they doing that makes them so effective? More effective than an actual brand, more effective than Harley, more effective than Apple, which means that the religious conversion text, I mean, the text that they use in order to convert you to that religion must be super effective.
Yeah. I mean, I've got my own 2 cents worth. When I go to church, the things that really keep me there is the cell group.
Yeah.
And the bonds and the camaraderies, like family within the cell group.
Yeah.
But my MH was first a broken home.
Yeah. Ah, okay. Interesting.
So you continue. I mean, that's just my 2 cents of why the church was so powerful to me.
Yeah. Which is good. So that's part of the scalable parable. There are 8 or 9 steps. Let me remember them because there's quite a lot of steps.
Yeah.
The first is the Romans,
mm-hmm.
the Virgin,
mm-hmm.
the miracles, the crucifixion,
mm-hmm.
the resurrection, the commission,
mm-hmm.
the ultimatum, or the invitation and the ultimatum.
Ah, okay. The ultimatum would be like the consequence.
Yeah, if you don't believe me, go to hell.
Yeah.
Because human beings are quite motivated by that. So
yeah.
So you need an ultimatum. You know, human beings don't jalan. Especially when you have information overload.
Yeah.
Then they actually navigate by putting out fires.
Okay.
Generally, so you need to start a fire for them to put out, I think. So.
Okay. That's quite a lot to digest. Can you give us like maybe a walkthrough?
Okay. I'll give you a quick walkthrough. So the Romans is basically what oppresses your customer.
Mm.
The Virgin is an accidental discovery of something that can change everything. The miracles is that one discovery changing a lot of lives.
Okay.
The crucifixion is that discovery being put under danger. That means adversity.
Okay.
The resurrection is basically you overcome the obstacle and now you're more powerful than you ever were before.
Okay.
Because anybody in a resurrected body is superior to a previous body. It's like if you never die at all, you won't be as powerful as after you're resurrected.
Okay.
Which is all the underdog story, all the sports and everything.
Yeah.
They came back and they're better than before. Yeah. Very. Then the next is the commission, which is what you said, the cell group, the bond. Yeah. The community, the invitation is basically come join us now, join the faith and all those things. And the ultimatum is there's consequences if you don't join this faith. And this is actually, you will find this in most other religious conversion texts, not just the gospel, but the rest as well.
Even in, what about Buddhism, Taoism? Do we see this kind of...
Buddhism and Taoism are adopted because they're not really religions, right? They're more of philosophies and... Like they do worship certain things, but ultimately it's actually a philosophy, which is slightly different, but I think it follows the same like beats. Yeah.
Okay. So really thank you for that framework. I think many people see that as very new things that they could adopt. Now, if let's say the entire sequence that you just said, all that needs to be condensed into 3 minutes, is that possible?
Yes. So I'm working on something. I don't know when it's going to come out. I don't know. I don't even know whether it's going to be a 2-day conference or an info product and everything.
Yeah.
Of all the principles I talk about.
Yeah.
I call it the marketing holy grail.
Okay.
Or holy grail marketing. So there is holy grail copywriting already that has these principles, but I want to do something that's more general marketing. So holy grail marketing basically talks about how you first know your market, then you create the UFO. You imbue that UFO with specific powers. That's the holy grail. Like something that they inject it with desirability.
Yeah.
You tell the story about the UFO in a scalable parable way.
Yeah.
And last, you scale it on social media and all the different marketing channels.
Okay.
So that's essentially the 5 steps.
Can this be used on homogeneous products?
What do you mean by homogeneous products?
Okay, for example, there are certain products out there, the sellers out there may be general stores there's many sellers selling the same thing.
Yeah.
And if we go through the whole religious story and process, that sounds like something unique that can be done on a new product that I created.
Yeah.
But what if somebody is selling a product that is just homogeneous, even like, for lack of a better one, say earphones.
Yeah. So there's a very interesting case study. It was done in the 30s. It was Schlitz beer.
Okay.
And what happened was Schlitz beer, they came out with a campaign. And they were talking about this process, which they process the barley hops. They use the purest of water.
Yeah.
So it's this really amazing step-by-step guide of beer.
Yeah.
The interesting thing is everyone else does the exact same thing.
Okay.
But nobody else talks about it.
Okay.
But because they were the first to talk about it,
okay,
they won the market share.
Okay.
And so when it comes to general products, is what the key is, what can you talk about that no one else is talking about? And again, I actually developed a framework for that as well. Okay. But there's a lot of frameworks.
Yeah.
It's called major and the minor.
Okay.
I won't go in depth into it, but the gist of it is the most minor things in a specific product, service, or person, if you blow it up, makes it the most interesting.
Okay. So that means even in a homogeneous product, there'll always be one or two things that people don't talk about that you take it and blow it up to make it your own.
Yeah, correct.
And that's how it makes you a bit more special.
Yeah.
And if you go through the whole Holy Grail story, that carves out your own pie of the market. Am I right to say that?
Yeah, because one of my customers has broccoli extract.
Okay.
And broccoli extract, how boring is it? Yeah. Broccoli extract, right? Yeah. But then I did the research. I used the major of the minor exercise.
Yeah.
And I realized that, broccoli is very interesting because it was championed by this Roman politician that ate a lot of it and ended up living 40 more years than his peers.
Okay.
So that's doing the research. And then, so the headline for this broccoli extract was, renegade Roman politician holds the key to everlasting youth.
Oh. Sounds mischievous, huh?
Yeah.
That's what you mean by the spin and the...
Yeah. So you find a minor thing. So that's very minor, like this weird Roman politician likes broccoli so much. He writes about it, everything.
Yeah.
But he really lived until, you know, the average lifespan was 40 years old. He lived until 80, so
Okay. So if I apply it to electronics, it would be that particular feature in that particular product suddenly gave this unique longevity.
Yeah, or you could be the place, like where was it manufactured? It could be the actual material itself.
From that part of that world.
Yeah, like graphene, like basically, or something. Yeah, so piece of magic. Yeah.
So coming back to my diapers.
Yeah.
Coming back to my diapers.
Yeah.
It has got a very special ingredient that comes from Japan, and the other ingredients comes from Europe, and it's comes together uniquely, blended of best of both worlds that beats the rest of the competition.
Yeah.
Something like that, is it?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, basically your product could be, you know, the baby now can wear the world on his ass.
Yeah, the baby can wear the world. Beautiful. I can't help but ask, who were your major influencers who impacted you in your life?
A lot.
Too much.
I think my pastors are good. Recently, I mean, I won't name names because you wouldn't know them anyway. Like, recently, my wife and I, Laura and I, we've been adopted into almost a group of billionaires and multi-millionaires.
Okay.
I call them heart-centered billionaires and multi-millionaires. And the way they think about money and life is very different.
Was that the conference you had in Bali?
Yes, that was the conference.
Okay.
Yeah, we might bring it to Malaysia, actually.
Yeah, I actually, when you were talking about it, I was like, oh, I'd like to go and take a look at that.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, can. There'll be a conference in Dubai this... hopefully by July, we'll have one in Dubai.
Okay.
In fact, Hillsong New York contacted us to do one in Madison Square.
Hillsong's?
Yeah.
Oh, they've been around for a long time.
Yeah. But we will see about that. So basically, these guys are very interesting because even though they're so rich, like I think one of them flew in private jet to Bali and everything.
Yeah.
But they cared about people more than anyone else I knew.
Okay.
Like they actually cared about human beings more than... Like, a few of them actually asked, Kenneth, how's your marriage? Let's talk about marriage. We want your marriage to be strong. Basically, they cared for you on a personal level.
Yeah.
And that really impacted me because then for them, money is actually inconsequential.
Yeah.
Money is easy to make. But it's the everything else that is harder. Like, there's no point making a lot of money if you don't have this sort of balance. mm-hmm. lifestyle.
But then again, the Bible says seek face the first of God, a face of God, and then yeah. money comes on the right hand.
Yeah, so it says seek ye first the kingdom of God, and all these things will be added unto
yeah.
you. An interesting thing, the word added unto you yeah. in the Greek means chase after you.
Yeah.
That means money chases after you, like blessing chases after you. Like the cow, the dog running yeah. after you.
Yeah. So does that mean that like in life, if yeah. we really follow our purpose first yeah. and seek a mission and seek to give value in that mission?
Yeah.
Money just chases you as you seek value, seek to provide value.
I believe so. So it needs to be accompanied by the fact you need to know what you're actually doing.
Yeah.
So
yeah,
you need to develop skills, you need to develop.
Yeah.
Because you can seek your purpose and be terrible at finance and cash flow.
Yeah.
So no point at all. Like, basically, you keep going into debt and all those things. So you develop the skills, but skills is not enough.
Yeah.
So your purpose, mission, and character is the second one.
Okay.
Because once you hit your purpose, are you able to sustain? Mm. When the world praises you.
Okay. I think that's really another open book, you know.
Yeah, like okay.
Achieving wealth is one, but yeah. retaining that wealth is not something that many people can keep.
Yeah. Either retaining that wealth, or you may keep that wealth and lose everything else.
Maybe, yeah. yeah. Sometimes it happens.
Because let's say you're a celebrity, right? Like, it's very different. Like, the dynamic is very different. Like,
yeah.
like people don't befriend you because they like you a yeah. lot of the time. They yeah. befriend you because they want something.
Okay. So now, I skip a bit. Huh? Yeah. Now that you're part of that group,
yeah.
what's the difference in thinking level with them? What do you observe?
They think about nation transformation. So okay. they think about how do I change the world? And okay. how do I change the world with business? So okay. it's not charity. Like I believe in charity and I believe in social entrepreneurship.
Yeah.
So we often say that, you know, we make money, we give back to society, right?
Yeah.
But giving back means you took something in the first place.
Yeah.
So, but what they actually think about is basically, this is business. Mm-hmm. How do we use business to impact lives?
Okay, win-win.
Win-win, yeah.
Okay.
Doing well by doing good. I think that's the...
Yeah. I have another friend called yeah. Vince Tan.
Okay, yeah.
You know Vince Tan.
Yeah, I know Vince very well.
He gave me something recently that yeah. quite simple yet profound.
Yeah.
Why people are not rich.
Yeah.
Because they only think of themselves.
Yeah.
Just think back into your teenage life, you know.
Yeah.
You an individual don't have any burden, nobody else to take care,
yeah.
but yet not enough money.
Yeah.
But when a person becomes a parent,
yeah.
suddenly there's somebody else to be responsible for. Yeah. And suddenly that person who used to have no money will have enough money
yeah.
to feed the family.
Yeah.
And he said the reason is because the individual now has expanded to have a responsibility towards someone else other yeah. than himself.
Yeah.
So he takes it one step further.
Yeah.
What if you think for the world?
Yeah, that's how the billions are made. Because billionaires, the reason why someone is a billionaire, the reason why someone is a millionaire, it's not so much skill set, you know.
Yeah.
It's because you have a product or service that serves a billion people. That's it. Basically, you have a market that's big enough.
So
that, yeah.
really that's 101 already.
Yeah.
If you create something
yeah.
that serves a billion people, even if it's just a very simple product,
yeah.
that becomes that service that gives you that money already.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Precisely. So
it really starts off with a thinking pattern that says, I want to do something to help the world first, right?
Yeah. Because providing for a family, you don't actually need a lot.
Yeah.
When I say don't need a lot, I mean yeah. not... like live like pauper, but they said that the average what $70,000 a year
yeah.
is enough to live very comfortably most parts
yeah.
of the world.
Yeah.
I mean, unless you're living in Paris and New York, it's a different thing.
Yeah.
But or San Francisco, but you live in Malaysia and all those $70,000 is super
very
a lot.
Comfortable.
Very comfortable.
Yeah, very comfortable.
Cannot spend finish it. Like,
yeah.
basically,
yeah.
right? But that's really all you need. You think about hey, 70,000, then why do I need to be a millionaire, right? Then basically it's so the world is blessed by your generosity.
Okay, that's a good way to think for anyone who's thinking too small.
Yeah.
Sorry to use the word thinking too small, but I have been through that stage in my life
yeah.
where I was selfish before. Then later I start to think more, I realize that prosperity really does come back.
Yeah.
And we start thinking of edifying or serving more.
Yeah, which is true.
Yeah.
It's very, very true.
So what's next for Kenneth Yu?
I'm launching a YouTube channel.
Cool.
It's called Attention Empire.
Okay.
So I'll be shooting videos, talking about storytelling, stuff like I talked to you about, influence. And also I'm going to examine things like how does story impact politics, branding, economics, and everything. I'm actually very interested in how storytelling impact markets.
Okay.
Market movements.
Okay.
So I've been talking narrative economics, they actually call it, it's a new term now.
Okay.
So I've been looking at all that, and you know, I have masterminds, I have mentoring programs are opening up.
Okay.
Like, I mean, thank you for telling me that, you know, I have something to offer the world in that regard. But I feel people, like, what's interesting is I start mentoring programs, people say, here's money, please. please mentor me.
Like, but that's precisely you following your passion, and yeah, money comes chasing you. Yeah,
literally, they come, they call, hey, come here. Yeah. Take lah, take. I'm like, okay, but I don't want to just take one lah, I'll take more. That's how it starts. And then, hey, quite a lot of people want to give me. I just realized I never made an offer. And that's the other thing. I think one of the key things that in business today, you need to start making offers.
Okay.
Of course, you can do too much. Like you make the offers first without providing value.
Yeah.
And that's terrible.
Yeah.
That's a lot of, actually a lot of Facebook is like that. They keep join this, lah, join that course, lah, join my MLM lah, and everything.
Yeah.
But I feel if you actually add enough value, when you start saying, hey, pay me for this,
yeah,
then people will actually come.
Okay.
That's what I noticed, because I actually added value for 10 years without asking a single cent. And that's why when I opened the doors, immediately like, eh, paper notification. I was like, oh, nice.
Cool.
Yeah.
Cool. How would you like to be remembered?
I actually wrote my eulogy.
Oh, cool. Tell us more.
I think I want to be remembered as somebody who loved my wife, loved my eventual kids. I don't have kids yet. I probably will have a few in the future. I want to be known as somebody who loved the people around me, and somebody who left a legacy for the world.
Okay.
I mean, there are the most surface things. Like, I want my ideas to be known worldwide.
Okay.
I want my, because my ideas are quite different, like basically in terms of storytelling, in terms of marketing.
Yeah.
I want the world, I want to make it mainstream. Like the way sales funnels are mainstream, the way innovation is mainstream.
What's the name of your discipline again?
Which discipline?
Okay, you see the thing, where am I coming from? Now, this was taught to me again.
Yeah.
Now you've got a lot of very unique ways of explaining and unique frameworks. The totality, has it got a name? And anything that has got a name of it, sounds more atas lah.
Yeah.
Sounds more atas and actually has got more value.
Yeah.
Yeah. So what's have you thought of the name yet?
I'm going to call it the Holy Grail for now.
Okay.
And the Holy Grail will be of a series of principles. But,
okay.
But I got, it's very easy for me to come up with names.
Yeah.
It just takes me longer to actually develop the content surrounding the names. Huh?
Yeah. I really look forward, actually.
Yeah.
I'll probably come to one of them.
Yeah,
just let
you.
Me know when. I always love to hear your new ideas of ways to frame things.
Yeah, thank you, thank you. Yeah. We will do more soon, so we'll see how it goes.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Last question. Now, in our audience, there'll be people who will be watching this, and some will understand, some will not understand.
Yeah.
There'll be people at different level. If you can give one piece of advice to the individual who's saying, I'm stuck, I don't know what I need to do to go to my next level, what would you advise that individual?
I would say you need to, first you need to know why you're stuck in the first place. There's two reasons why you're stuck. The first reason is you're in the right path, and it's just a matter of time before you break through, because a tree can only grow in the process of time. You plant a seed and then you just wait forever, and then suddenly something shoots out, right? So it's a process of time, hang on. The second, you totally don't know what you're doing. you're in the wrong direction, your ladder is on the wrong wall. Then if you're stuck because it's a lack of skill, ability and direction, then you need to get a different direction, get a different skill, or get a job.
Maybe.
Yeah, so those are the two possibilities.
Cool. And anything that our camera lady wants to ask? Yeah, she's been observing for some time.
Yeah, she's good. Hi,
yeah,
Andy.
She's been laughing there. So.
Yeah.
Yeah. And if I didn't cover things that you all have been thinking about, I'm sorry. If you do have any questions that you'd like to further ask me or even ask Kenneth, feel free to just write in the comments, And let us get back to you on that one. Okay, and signing off today. Again, thank you for watching, and thank you, Kenneth, for really being with me together today. Really appreciate that.
No worries.
Okay, have a good day, ladies and gentlemen. Anything else to say to general, ladies and gentlemen?
Gong hei fa choy.
Gong hei fa choy. Gong hei fa choy. Yeah, it's about to be Chinese New Year. Yeah. Day two. And we are working here.
Working.
That's dedication.
So
right? give other gifts.
Yeah, gift.
Okay, signing off. Bye, ladies and gentlemen.
Bye-bye. Sing.